So good afternoon, and we are very happy to have all of you here today. So we actually are very lucky to have a respectable speaker here, Dr. Sumithra Raganathan. I'm going to give a short brief introduction about our speaker today. She's our consultant radiologist and clinical head of Department of Radiology and Nuclear Medicine Services from Prince Court Medical Center. She's also an adjunct professor of radiology, School of Medicine at Taylor's University. She graduated from Manipal in 1992, worked as a medical officer till 1997, before pursuing her master's in radiology. She obtained her master's degree in 2001 from UM and obtained a certificate in 2001 as a fellow in the remote fellowship neuroradiology, brain spine MRI and CT, MRI online Cincinnati, Ohio. She worked for a year and a half in the radiology department of HKL and then as a lecturer in the Department of Biomedical Imaging and Radiology in the University Malaya Medical Center for 4 years. She then followed a career in Sime Darby Medical Center for a year and subsequently joined Prince Court Medical Center in 2007. She is a general radiologist with a special interest in women's imaging and breast intervention work. She used to give lectures on breast imaging in the specialist breast nurses courses in Prince Court, as well as for the radiographer's degree program in medical imaging in UITM. She has published numerous articles in radiology journals and has also presented her work on imaging of reconstructed breast post-mastectomy in an international conference in the European Congress of Radiology in Vienna. So we are very proud to present our speaker today. Please give her a round of applause. Thank you.
Thank you very much for inviting me. Thank you for the warm welcome. So my talk today is on what's old, what's new, and what works, a clinician's perspective. This topic was actually, when I told somebody this, and I was suggesting that I would talk about, and they said, why don't you try this heading or this title? And I was like, what were you thinking? Okay, so I hope you've all brought your pillows and your blankets, because there's a lot of things in radiology that you think. So you're going to stay with me this whole night, okay? If you're prepared for that, welcome to this talk, okay? So what I'm going to be talking about basically is a brief history of radiology, modalities and evolution of modalities, diagnostic as well as treatment that we can use with radiology, and the future of radiology. Just to let you know that 8th of November every year is considered International Day of Radiology. Okay, it was because that was the first day Brunton discovered X-rays while experimenting with cathode radiation, and he found that X-ray passed through human tissue, leaving bones and metal visible. Okay, so the first X-ray that he ever did was that of his wife Bertha's hand, and when she actually looked at that image, she actually had said, "I've seen my death." And thing. Then, of course, the other things that went on after discovery of X-rays by Brunton was in 1942. Carl de Sick was credited with being the first to use ultrasonic waves as a diagnostic tool. He transmitted ultrasound beams through the human skull in attempts of detecting brain tumors. Of course, today we don't do that anymore, but we actually use ultrasound to do transcranial Dopplers, and of course in babies as well. So in babies, because the fontanelle is open, we can actually look at things, right? But generally, adults, we have a very thick skull in most cases, okay? So next, 1949, a radiologist in Uruguay introduced compression technique in breast imaging. That was the first modern mammogram. He actually did it mastectomy specimens, and he did the compression technique, and he found that he could actually see images. This was later made perfected by using intensifying screen. A physician in Houston produced even clearer images of breast. In 1969, the first dedicated mammography unit became available for use around the world. Okay, that was basically your commercial mammograms. 2000, digital imaging became the preferred method of breast imaging, followed by 3D breast imaging technology 11 years later. Today, we have a lot more in the field of radiology, especially in breast imaging. The first CT scanner was discovered in 1967 by Sir Godfrey Hounsfield, which is why we use the CT value, we call it the Hounsfield unit. And the first MRI machine was used in 1977. I have to say, I cannot for the life of me remember the guy's name. Okay. Radiologists are clinicians too. I think a lot of people forget that. And this was brought up to me by Prof. Ganesh to say that, yes, we are clinicians too. So thank you for that. Okay. We don't spend all day in a dark room looking at images, just most of the day. Okay. And in today's day and age, we actually don't even use the dark room anymore. We're all digitalized. So all of us have computer screens like this, big, small, different sizes, and we're actually looking at images. Okay. If you go to a radiology department and you actually ask for an examination, the first thing the radiologist will ask you is indication, indication, indication. I remember this very clearly because when I was a houseman, I went to request for an ultrasound from the radiologist, the then person that we used to call the father of radiology in Malaysia, okay, Prof. Samad. And I asked him, I said, I want an ultrasound for a patient of mine. And he said, what's wrong with your patient? I said, he has liver cirrhosis. And he said, so? I said, so I need an ultrasound. And he said, he's got liver cirrhosis. He's going to die. So what's the point of an ultrasound? And that hit me like a ton of bricks because he said, you need to tell me that you think the patient is going into liver failure. You need to do that. You need to exclude things. You need to see what kind of treatment that he needs, which is why we keep saying indication, indication, indication. Okay. And another of my ex-bosses used to say, nobody orders radiologists because everybody will say, I ordered an X-ray, I ordered a CT scan. Nobody orders. You order Roti Chennai or Tetharic. You request for an X-ray. You request for an imaging modality. Okay? So why we say we are clinicians is basically because we need history. We need history because we need to put together the pieces of puzzle, which basically combined with imaging, okay, gives rise to a diagnosis or at least some sort of a differential diagnosis. So we're very good at jigsaw puzzles, okay? So at the end of the day, we can actually give you a full image or at least three quarters of an image if we miss that one piece. Okay, radiologists, we deal with shades of gray, different shades of gray, okay? And we don't just deal with 50 shades of gray, we actually deal with 256 shades of gray. Okay, so welcome to the radiology suite. I'm now going to give you a virtual tour of the radiology department. Okay, basic hospitals nowadays come with these four modalities, at least if nothing else. Okay, the plain X-ray, which gives rise to all your chest radiographs, your extremities and all of that. Okay, then of course you have your ultrasound, the CT scanners and fluoroscopy. So most radiology departments, however small the hospital is, would have these four main imaging modalities. Other than that, of course, you would have the mammogram, okay, be it 2D, 3D, or contrast enhanced. You would, in some hospitals, you actually are lucky enough to have an angiography suite, and you would have MRI. And of course, not all hospitals are equipped with PET scans, but we're getting there. So modalities and uses, basically you have them for diagnostic use and therapeutic. So diagnostic would be your plain X-rays, and it can be just your basic plain cassette film, computer radiography or digital. Fluoroscopy, again the same, either computer or digital. Ultrasound, your CT scanners, MRIs, mammograms, contrast enhanced mammography, nuclear medicine, angiography. These all can be used for diagnostic. Therapeutic, you can use fluoroscopy for therapy. You can use ultrasound, like even ultrasound for guided intussusception reduction, to do some nephrostomies, okay, aneurysm coiling, thrombolectomy, PICC, central lines, stents, microwave ablation, radiofrequency ablation, and so on and so forth. Plain radiographs, they're cheap, they're easy to use or easy to obtain, widely available. Every GP, clinics nowadays come with X-ray unit, okay? The downside of it is that there's radiation and it's not very, very sensitive. Okay, so we used to use cassettes. So you actually have a dark room where you actually wash the films, as we call it, and you produce these films which are actually given to all the clinicians. Okay, then of course we came up with computer radiography and digital radiography. I don't know whether you can see that, but that's supposed to be okay. Part of your Zoom is actually covering that, but can anybody guess what that is? So that's a plain film, okay? It's an image of a calcified structure there. It's actually a AAA, okay? Abdominal aortic aneurysm. Why we say the radiographs are not very sensitive is that you would not see that unless it was calcified. So plain X-ray, you may miss AAAs, okay? So it is, but don't dish the, your plain X-rays, okay? I will tell you why. So workflow, we went on to do computer radiography. It was a little bit better. You didn't have the screen and the films. You didn't have to watch the images. These were basically printed out using a machine that you just put in the cassette and your images would come out. And then, of course, today, most places have digital radiography, okay? So when the images are taken, you can actually adjust the exposure units. You can actually label it accordingly. And the downside of digital is that sometimes it can be labeled wrongly, okay? Because the radiographers are in a hurry. So you have to be very, very careful about that. Okay. So like I said, the plain radiograph, the plain chest X-ray, okay? During COVID, that was the most widely used machine, okay? We had easiest because you actually have portable X-ray machines. You could take it to the isolation room. We would do X-rays, and that's how we diagnose patients, whether they were category 1, 2, 3, 4, and whether they need ventilation and so on. And then, of course, we also used a CT scan to, if they're really bad and you needed to do a CT scan, you would proceed with that. But in the radiograph, it was so much easier because you could actually move the machine. You didn't have to worry about waiting for the room to be cleaned up and things like that after doing a CT scan, which we did, okay? Fluoroscopy. So the fluoroscopy machine can also be used for basic stuff, okay? Like your barium studies, myelograms, MCUs, and things like that. Can anybody tell me what's wrong with the barium study? Which year are you all at? Curious. Second year. Okay. Do you all do clinical work yet? No? Okay. All right. But you've seen X-rays? You've gone to X-ray. I mean, you've gone to the radiology department at some point in time? No, you haven't. Okay. X-ray is done. All right. Okay. So just to let you know, that's situs inversus. Okay. You did realize that it was the appendix is on the wrong side. Yes, absolutely. Okay. Yeah, so that's situs inversus, right? Okay, so myelograms. Today, we rarely, rarely do myelograms because we actually have MRI machines. So you can actually do MR myelography. So we wouldn't actually puncture unnecessarily to do, and most people don't like being poked. So yeah. Okay, and like I said, you can do basic like your HSGs, your micturating cystourethrograms, you can do nephrostomies and things like that with the fluoroscopy machine. So we also use it therapeutically to reduce intussusception in children. We diagnose it usually using ultrasound, and then we would either do ultrasound-guided reduction or barium reduction, okay? Of course, barium reduction is a lot easier because ultrasound, you have to actually put in a lot of water to see that, okay? Then, of course, the basic ultrasound machine, okay, it's painless, no radiation, it's cheaper than a CT scan or an MRI, and it's portable, so you can actually take it anywhere to ICU, to CCU, anywhere that you want to, you can do ultrasound. And of course, ultrasounds can be used for Dopplers, which means you can actually use it for to look at vessels, whether it's arterial, veins, things like that, anything you can actually use the Doppler as well, okay? And of course, nowadays, I mean, in most gynae clinics, private clinics especially, they like to give people the pictures of their babies. So you're actually from 2D, you've actually got 4D ultrasound machines where you can actually look at the baby's face better. Okay. In ultrasound, there is another part of ultrasound or a thing that's added onto new machines. Okay, it's called elastography and shear wave. Okay, we do strain imaging or shear wave elastography to look at things like tumors. So liver tumors, breast tumors, basically fatty livers, we actually do shear wave imaging. Okay, it's either strain imaging or it's shear wave imaging. Okay. And based on certain measurements, we would actually tell you whether this is malignant or benign. Diagnostic ultrasound, we can use ultrasound guided FNAC, pleural tapping, you can do drainages, you can do biopsies. Okay, so this is what we do, an ultrasound guided biopsy. You can actually see the needle very nicely to take a sample of the tissue. Okay, so we do it with kidney biopsies, liver biopsies, any tumor mass that is accessible by ultrasound, your lymph nodes, things like that, we would actually use ultrasound to do the biopsy. So that's diagnostic. Therapeutic, we can actually do injections with ultrasound. So nowadays, it's so much easier because there's a lot of clinicians who use the ultrasound to actually inject into joints, into muscles, into areas where you think that there's some sort of treatment that's needed. Of course, the mammography unit is available in most hospitals. It's either 2D or 3D. So this is the 3D unit. Okay. So with the 2D, you may, oops, sorry, I'm just going back to that picture. Okay, so with the 2D, you can sort of, something's, okay, it's very sensitive. Okay, you can actually see that there, I've circled a picture and that's actually a tumor. Sometimes the breast is very dense, you may not see it. But with the 3D, let's see how nicely I can move this. Okay, with the 3D, let's see if that works. Yes, if you look at a 3D image, you can actually see the tumor so much better, right? So that's the advantage of 3D imaging. And most places now we do recommend, especially in people who've got dense breasts. Okay. So I was fortunate enough to actually go through all three mammography units and now even the fourth one, actually. I've gone on to doing from the first screen film, the manual one. I moved on to CRM or computer radiography, and I also did. I was fortunate enough to use the full field digital mammogram as well, and now I actually do 3D mammographs as well. So I actually wrote a paper on that. Okay, still with me? Okay, good, right. Okay, CT scans. The first CT brain took 2.5 hours. Okay, to do, and you actually had really, really pixelated images. If you can see the one on the top on the right-hand side, it's actually really, really pixelated. Okay, and images. But today things have improved in leaps and bounds. We started off with 4 slices. So when I was actually studying doing my master's, we actually had 16-slice CT scan, and we thought that was great. Then we moved on to 64, and today there's actually 106. I mean, 640-slice CT scan machines available. You also have dual source CT where you actually have two tubes. Okay. Most of the dual source is actually used for cardiac work rather than normal work, but it's really, really fast. So if you do a CTA coronary, it takes you maximum 4 seconds to do a CTA coronary. The whole process takes a few minutes, but to actually acquire an image is only 4 seconds. Downside of CT scan is radiation. Okay. But we can actually do so much with the CT scan. So strokes, we actually move on to do stroke imaging nowadays because it's so crucial. If anybody comes with a stroke, within the first 6 hours, you have to detect and diagnose it. Of course, CT is not as sensitive as an MR to look at acute strokes, but you can actually do CT perfusion. Okay, so we look at the cerebral blood volume, your mean transit time of the blood flow, and we would be able to tell you if the tissue is viable or not. We can also do CT angiograms in any part of the body, your upper limb, lower limbs, abdominal aortic aneurysms, renal for patients who are going in for renal transplant, we actually do a CT scan of the CT angiography of the renal arteries of the donor, because we need to see which kidney is better and which artery is more accessible to do that. Okay, so we actually done so much. I mean, the CT scan has actually moved on leaps and bounds today. And like I said, we also do CTA coronaries. So it's no more saying that if you suspect a patient has a heart problem, you don't really need to go in and do an angiogram. You can actually do a CTA coronary. Of course, there's criteria for that. What we do is we look at the calcium deposits on the blood vessels. If the calcium deposits are very, very high, we usually take a cutoff point of above 600. If it's more than 600, we will not proceed with a CTA coronary because it's not ethical. Your calcium deposits are white on a CT scan. Contrast is also white. So sometimes it would obscure any small lesions. So any patient, the calcium score is lower, you suspect that they might have an abnormal stress test, we would proceed to do a CTA coronary where you would actually inject a contrast or dye into the veins and thing instead of, you know, doing a puncture, an arterial puncture, things like that, okay, of femoral puncture, sorry. Then, of course, you use the CT scan for guided biopsies as well, okay? So you can actually do a biopsy of a lung nodule, tumor in the liver, and things like that. You can do CT-guided drainages, okay? So that's actually a collection post-pancreatitis, okay? The patient had a collection. Now, the surgeon doesn't want to go in and cut because it's, you know, it is more difficult. There's a lot of inflammation going around there. The easiest thing to do would be to bring down all his values and his white blood cell counts and things like that, would be to do a CT-guided drainage. MRI, of course, no radiation, but it's more expensive. It takes a lot of time, okay? And if your patients are claustrophobic, it's quite difficult, okay? But you can look at a lot of fine things. So this is a recent patient of mine, just came in with nothing but headache. And that was something that was picked up by the MRI, was the pericolosal artery thrombosis. Okay. Lucky for him, he didn't have a stroke or anything like that. You can do MRAs, you can do MRVs as well. Okay. So like I was telling you, we do MRI in acute strokes today. The first 6 hours is very, very crucial to the neurologist and for the patient, because you can actually save a patient. So as soon as they come in with symptoms within the first 6 hours, if they've we do an MRI. And so most of the time, most emergency rooms are very close to the radiology department because of this. Okay. So in this patient, it's an acute stroke because he has what we call restricted diffusion. Okay. And we move on to do that. So that would actually make the patient, the neurologist be able to decide whether he needs thrombolysis or thrombolectomy. Okay. We also do MRI of the breast. Okay. To diagnose cancers. To people with dense breasts, high risk, young patients, strong family history of breast cancers. So dense breasts, we would actually proceed with an MRI, because sometimes if they're young, you wouldn't do a mammogram for them. Okay, an ultrasound may not pick up things. So you would actually do an MRI of the breast. And when we give contrast, the tumor lights up, and then we would look at certain values to be able to tell you whether this is a tumor or not. Okay. So in this case, the patient actually has breast cancer, which is lighting up as you can see. Okay. Then again, sometimes ultrasounds do pose a bit of a challenge to us. So this patient actually came in because she had filler injections. Fillers are little chemical augmentations of the breast. Okay. So she had something that we weren't sure whether it was a tumor, because it looked like a tumor. So we went on to do an MRI for her. And it was confirmed just a foreign body granuloma. Okay. Of course, we can do every part of the body with MRI. So musculoskeletal, abdominal imaging. Okay. That's like bread and butter for most hospitals nowadays. It's moved on. We can do fiber tracking, functional imaging. So if a patient has a tumor today, the neurosurgeons will come back and tell you, I need fiber tracking and functional imaging. Why? Because to be able to tell you which fibers are involved. Is the tumor crossing, or are the fibers overlapping it, crossing the tumor, things like that. So we've actually moved on in leaps and leaps and bounds. I have to admit, though, not all hospitals do this, okay? It's not so easy. You really have to be trained. So most time you have a neuroradiologist who reads these images, okay, who'll be able to tell you these things, okay? So that's fiber tracking and functional imaging. And types of MRI machines. So you have a 0.5 Tesla, you have a 1 Tesla, you have 1.5 Tesla, you have 3 Tesla. 7 Tesla machines are only used for research purposes, not otherwise. So some hospitals, we have 1.5 and 3. 1.5 is still the workhorse. Okay, you would use that for almost everything. 3 Teslas, mostly for brain imaging and musculoskeletal. Very, very good. Okay. In some hospitals, if you're lucky and you're claustrophobic, you might actually have a standing MRI. So at the moment, I think I only know one hospital in KL that has a standing MRI. And then that little last picture there is actually that of a patient. You've got extremity MRI. So you've got smaller machines where you put in your hand or your leg, so you don't actually have to put the whole body in, and you can actually do that. Again, only a few hospitals actually have that. Everything comes with a cost. Nuclear medicine. When I started off studying, everybody called it unclear medicine because we really didn't understand nuclear medicine. So we said it was unclear medicine. But today we actually know so much about it, and there is so much that you can actually do with nuclear medicine. You can use it for diagnosis in anything and everything. So you can use it as functional imaging as well. Okay. And you can also use it for diagnosis, for treatment, post-treatment. If you actually want to follow up on a patient to see whether how good their response to treatment was, you can actually use nuclear medicine, PET scans, gamma scans, things like that. Okay. So the pictures that you're actually seeing is a patient who's got extensive metastasis from breast cancer. So the nuclear med, when you do a PET scan, you can actually see where all, which parts of a body are actually involved with things. So you can do it pre-treatment and post-treatment. It actually allows the physician to pinpoint the location of the cancer within the body, and you have the ability to monitor patient's response to therapy. You can use it for myocardial perfusions. Basically, that's to see the viability of heart muscles, okay? So if a patient has had a massive infarct, you can actually do myocardial perfusion studies to look at, and you can do it with stress in the sense that you can actually inject radionuclei into the patient, and you can stress his heart, and you can actually get images to tell you whether that part of the heart is functioning or not. You can use it for kidneys to look at function of the kidneys, what we call a DTPA scan. We tend to use this especially in young children, because you want to see functioning kidneys. You want to see whether there's any obstruction. They're born some kidneys. Some children are born with obstructed kidneys. So when you do that, you can actually do a DTPA scan, because ultrasound can only give you so much. Interventional radiology. Okay, don't fall asleep so fast. You kept coming towards the end. Okay, interventional radiology. Okay, why we use interventional radiology? Basically, if you have, like I showed you, the collection, you can drain organs that have the potential of causing deadly infection. You can remove blood clots that could result in a stroke. Okay, you can prevent extreme and life-threatening bleeding due to various conditions, postpartum hemorrhage, GI bleeds, trauma, bleeding and trauma. Okay, you can do thrombolectomies. You can do stenting of vessels. Uterine fibroids, we do uterine artery embolization to reduce the size of fibroids, to preserve fertility, okay, to eradicate certain tumors. We can do chemoembolization, microwave ablation, or radiofrequency ablation, as we call it. So interventional, this is actually a basilar artery aneurysm. Those days, you would straight away go to a neurosurgeon, they would cut, and you would have a lot of downside to it, in the sense that the patient would actually have a big cut in their skull. You would actually have to shave their head. Recovery takes a lot longer and all that. I'm not saying that angiography or coiling is 100% and it's safe, okay, because it can go wrong as well, but it's less invasive. So today, if it is amenable, the neurosurgeons might tell you, okay, why don't you try coiling the aneurysm rather than actually cutting it, okay? So we actually do that as well. Thrombolysis, like I said, in strokes, if this patient has an MCA infarct, it was diagnosed, we did the MRA, and we saw that his right middle cerebral artery was actually blocked. So we actually went to do post-thrombolysis. And after thrombolysis, you see, you can actually see the vessel really, really well. So this patient has a very good chance of actually reducing his the effect of the stroke on the brain, okay? CT-guided radiofrequency ablations. We also can do ultrasound-guided radiofrequency ablations where you actually put in a needle and you actually burn the tumor. You can do cryoablations. You can do microwave ablations. So this is using radiofrequency. Through CT guidance, you actually go into the tumor and you actually burn the tumor. And then you do a follow-up scans after that. Angiographically, you can do uterine artery embolization, huge fibroid, post-embolization. It will take time, about 4 to 6 weeks, and then you can actually see that the uterine fibroid actually shrinks. This is not available yet in Malaysia, but it's something that we're looking at. It's called radioiodine seeding. Radioiodine seeding can be used in cases where you actually have metastasis in the lungs, in parts of the body. You can actually use radioiodine to put it into parts of that tumor, and you can actually use it for treatment. It can also be used to localize tumors. So in breast imaging, people are talking about it. Instead of using hook wires at the time of biopsy, you actually put in a radioiodine seed, and then the surgeon actually uses the gamma probe to remove the tumor during time of surgery, which would be probably 2 or 3 weeks later. Today, almost every field of medicine uses radiology in some form of the or the other. Okay, and all radiologists have become most radiologists have become subspecialized. So you either become a head and neck radiologist, you do, neuro radiology, you do neuro interventional radiology, you do peripheral interventional radiology, pediatric radiology, chest radiology. So there are umpteen fields of radiology that you can actually subspecialize into, okay? Every part of the body can be imaged, as you can see. And it is really, really amazing when you actually work in the department and you actually see the images, it is something else. But every field with exception of ultrasound has radiation. So why we have to, as radiologists, we have to be very, very careful. That's why we insist on indication, because is the examination indicated for to do this, because you're exposing a patient to radiation. Now, a natural background radiation is equivalent to 3 millisieverts is what we say for a year. Okay, it's equivalent to 1 day of background radiation. If you fly, it takes about 4 days of background radiation. A chest x-ray is equivalent to 1 day of background radiation. And as you move on and so forth, you would see that a PET scan would be anywhere between 7 to 8 years as well. So you really, really have to think, do you want to put a patient through that background radiation? And unfortunately, I would say that today we actually use radiology so much and without thinking about it, but we really need to and see whether the patient really needs it. You have to think that future, there is always a bit of radiation that's left behind in your body. Okay, as much as we try to be careful. So we go by the principle of ALARA, which is as low as reasonably achievable. Okay, the amount of radiation. So risk, however small, exists from any radiation dose. As we say, with great power comes great responsibility. Okay, right. Okay. Today, the field of radiology has advanced so much. Okay, really, really. I can't even begin to tell you how much. Okay, which is why I said, unless you're planning to bring your bed and blanket here to stay with me, I can go on and on. But otherwise, we would stop around here. Okay, imaging tests, we do that instead of exploratory surgery. So that would give the clinician, sort of a diagnosis. We do digital imaging. You can do cloud-based archives. So if a patient were moving forward towards that, in the sense that your images would be stored in the cloud. So if you go to another hospital, the clinician at that hospital should be able to access your image instead of putting you through another examination, okay? It makes things a lot easier because the world has become a lot smaller, okay? And people move around. Remote viewing, like I say, okay? I can sit here and view images from my hospital or anywhere else in the world if people choose to show them to you. We have moved towards radiation dose reduction. So we are governed by the IAEA, which is what you call international body, where they actually check on the amount of radiation. Each hospital actually has to go through your QA assessments. And you would be audited based on the amount of radiation that you actually put a patient through. And of course, interventional radiology, okay? So will radiologists ever be, upstaged or replaced by artificial intelligence? Not yet, I would like to think, because I think although radiology is an integral part of the entire medical field, the primary purpose of AI is actually for better decision-making to improve patient outcomes. It helps us a lot, okay? But you still need that human touch. So as budding doctors, please don't forget that. You need that human touch, okay? Because imagine if you put any one of your family member through another doctor. What do you want to do? Okay. Okay. I'm just going to show you a little thing that I actually like. So this is, I don't know whether you can actually hear it. Will we be able to get some sound in it? Okay. So like I said, radiologists, we like shades of gray, right? So can I try playing it? Oops. You've got music.
I see trees of green, red roses too. I see them bloom for me and you, and I think to myself, what a wonderful world. I see skies of blue and clouds of white, the bright blessed day, dark sacred night, and I think to myself, what a wonderful world. The colors of the rainbow, so pretty in the sky, are also on the faces of people going by. I see friends shaking hands, saying, how do you do? They're really saying, I love you. I hear babies cry. I watch them grow. They learn much more than I never knew. And I think to myself, what a wonderful world. Yes, I think to myself, what a wonderful world.
Radiologist, we started off integrating shadows and now we've actually got pictures. Okay. All right.
Sorry, I'd like to say this. So just for time, let's just say I'm always right. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Dr. Such an enlightening session. I think we'll all agree, very inspirational. Maybe some of them are budding radiologists. Yeah. Any questions, please feel free to ask. Any questions at all?
Yes. Prof, I got two questions. One is, what do you think about, because we saw quite a lot of people are offering screening CT scan, just for routine screening CT scan, pick up something that may not be the six. What's your opinion on that? Second is, in Malaysia, do we have this? Because I know a lot of people go on good therapy, especially for the lungs, for the lung, countless local therapy, but when we do local therapy, there are a lot of respiratory movement. So do we have any that will it be able to target that module during the patient's normal respiration, or is this the whole area, or are we very specific on certain areas in our?
Okay, your first question, CT screening, thank you for the question. CT screening, it's not fair for me to actually say anything because each hospital has a different policy. But if you were my friend, I would tell you don't do it, okay? Because you can actually do ultrasound screening. Of course, people, it's private hospitals, every hospital. I would actually encourage people to do screening, okay? Because we do pick up a lot of things, right? But your mainstay would be your blood tests, your basic, maybe your chest x-ray, if you smoke or if you hang around with people who smoke and things like that, family history, things like, you know, a basic ultrasound, which has no radiation at all. CT scan, unless you know exactly what you look for or if any of your tumor markers are raised, then we would recommend doing a CT scan, or if, let's say, we think an ultrasound might not be useful, okay? Sometimes pancreatic lesions may not be very easily detected on ultrasounds. We do CT scans. But again, you can actually do an MRI. Why would you want to do a CT for that, okay? Because of the radiation dose. So if you were to ask me, my personal feeling, I would think it's not ethical, but I have no right to say that. Okay, so basically, I would say don't go for a CT screening because the amount of radiation you're exposing yourself to is a bit high. The second question, I'm not a radiation oncologist, which is different from radiology. So that one, basically today, the field of radiation oncology also has actually gone, you know, it's actually moved in leaps and bounds. So it's actually very, very targeted. So even if they do radiation for particular lung nodules, which actually we don't do anymore so much, we actually target bones for radiation. We do breast post mastectomies, looking at lymph nodes, head and neck, things like that. Then you would do radiation oncology or radiation for this patient. Lung nodules, generally no. Lung nodules, either you would cut it out or you would put the patient through chemotherapy. So, but I have to be honest, you would need to probably get more information from a radiation oncologist rather than from me. I hope that answers that question.
Thank you so much.
Any other questions?
Can I ask a dumb question?
No question is dumb.
Yes, no question.
Whether I can answer it is a different question.
But you are right every time, so don't worry.
See, this is regarding the CT angiogram of the coronaries.
Yes.
See, I see some of the shots you showed there. I was extremely
impressed.
Clear, impressive. Yes. So when you're getting such clear images, how superior is it to an angiogram in the form of diagnosis? I know angiogram is both therapeutic as well as diagnostic. So if somebody can, you can make such good films and get such good diagnosis, why? So I just want to know which why is would, more sensitive. Why should I go and expose myself to the risk of an angiogram?
Okay. The angiogram is still considered the gold standard. Okay, it is still the gold standard.
Yes.
But because like you said, it's diagnostic and therapeutic. But in patients who, let's say, who come for screening, you do a stress test, okay? We are very sensitive
and in the sense that we might over-report, because if you do have a narrowing, which we look at, and when we do the CT scan, maybe a 30% stenosis or 40% stenosis can look like a 50 or 60% stenosis to us, which is what we would report as mild, moderate, or severe stenosis. And then you would actually have to go on to do an angiogram. And sometimes your angiogram might actually tell you it's only a 30% stenosis. So in an angiogram, you're actually looking at the lumen rather than the whole vessel per se, whereas in a CT scan, we're actually looking at vessels. But yes, with the newer machines, you actually have fairly, I would say, about 95 to 98% accuracy as far as CTs are concerned for a coronary angiogram. Younger patients who come in, high family history, you wouldn't want to do an invasive procedure for them. This is very, but they can just walk in fasting. You just go into the thing, your heart rate's normal. You don't need to worry. You, as long as your kidney functions are fine, we would actually inject, the amount of contrast injected in a CTA coronary would be about 80 mils compared to if you do an angiogram, it would actually be a lot more. So yes, if you're screening, I would tell you do a CTA coronary rather than an angiogram. So hope that answers it, sir.
Any other questions from the students?
I hope I didn't put any of you to sleep. Okay.
Maybe, doctor, I can ask you a question on behalf of our final year students who will be housemen soon.
All right.
What is the best way to approach a radiologist when requesting for an X-ray? I've been through it. It's not easy process.
Yeah, not easy process.
Thank
God.
Please share some tips with them so they can keep through their
okay. Let me start off with my time, okay, which was yongs ago. Okay, I started off being a houseman under very, very strict radiologists. So if you go to see to request for an ultrasound or a CT scan or whatever, first of all, you need to know your facts. You're not allowed to take folders, you're not allowed to take that. And the radiologist can ask you, so what's his creatinine? And you have to know it at the top of your head. All right. Okay. And we used to manage a lot of wards. Of course, times have changed. You guys are different. You have a lot more exciting things happening in the department. But saying that, know why you're requesting for an examination. Like I said, most radiologists want to know indication. If your indication is really, really something that we think, yes, agreed, this is something. We would actually, you can have a discussion with the radiologist. You can turn around and say, we've been asked to come and request for an ultrasound, but, that would be the basic modality. So the clinician, the radiologist might turn around and say, don't do an ultrasound. Do a CT scan. And then, of course, you can go back and say to your superior or whatever. But polite, know your indication. And at the end of the day, know why you're requesting for an examination. That's all. Okay. I was a lecturer for some time. Students used to come and ask me, or house officers used to come and ask me, can I get an ultrasound? And if I ask them, why do you want an ultrasound for this patient? They would turn around and tell me, I don't know. It's actually my friend's patient. I'm just doing a favor. Don't do that. Okay. If you want to request for an examination, it's always good to know why you're requesting for an examination and know your patients, okay? You need to have that rapport with your patients. I think that makes a lot of difference. If you know your patients, trust me, your clinician would just turn around and say, okay, go ahead and do it, okay?
Any questions? Is a question about radiology?
You have a question?
I'll just check for
that. Yeah, sure. See you.